Thank you for coming here this morning. We're here to talk about Ruby and the Ruby community in India. And I'll just introduce ourselves quickly first. My name is Sidhu. I do my open source here. That's my alias on GitHub. And I'm on Twitter here. And this is...
Hi, I'm Niranjan. I do my open source here on GitHub. And this is my Twitter handle.
So yeah, we're going to do a bit of to and fro here because it's a little hard to manage with the mic, so bear with us. We both work at C42 Engineering, which is a boutique Ruby services firm that we founded about 10 months ago in India. That's our company open source, this thing right there on GitHub, C42. Before this, we spent about maybe he was in ThoughtWorks for about 2 or 3 years. I was in ThoughtWorks for 5 years. So we worked in other companies before starting this again in the services industry, again, largely in Ruby for several years. So yeah, wanna get started?
Yep. So before I actually jump into the talk itself, I'd like to set up a context. So this talk is mostly going to be about how things work when it comes to software services industry in India, specifically in Ruby. We are going to talk about what Ruby is today and what we anticipate it is going to be in future in, say, 5 years' time. You have to keep it in mind that whatever opinions we have are really subjective and they might differ from person to person. Now, how is it relevant to you guys, our audience? We are making a couple of assumptions about you all, that you either sell Ruby or buy Ruby, services, products, doesn't matter. You consume Ruby in some manner. That's what is important. If you're buying Ruby services from India, it's important to understand both advantages and limitations of distributed development. If you are sending work, Ruby work, understanding how Ruby business works in India will give you a good context to make better decisions. We have spent nearly 6 years in offshore software development in companies as diverse as Infosys, ThoughtWorks, and now C42 Engineering. We understand distributed development fairly well. We are also going to spend some time talking about our experiences in this area and how it works, while remaining agile, and especially in the context of Ruby. We'll talk about ground realities, realities of the market, so that as a buyer, you can make informed decision. We'll talk about what it is like to be a seller in the market, both as an employee, as a consultant, and as a promoter of the firm. But this is what it is today, and we expect the situation to change in the coming 5 years. We'll talk about why we believe that real opportunities for Rubies in India lies elsewhere. It's not in services market. We see enormous opportunity in the local market because India is very strong democracy with around 100 million strong English speaking middle class and around 700 million strong non-English speaking rural class. And this is completely untapped market, and Ruby and its ecosystem is perfectly placed for building software for this market because everybody needs software. So that's about the context. We'll talk about now a little bit of history.
So yeah, just to understand where things are today, let's just look back at the last 5 years. I basically got involved with Ruby around 2005 when I first joined ThoughtWorks. This was sort of very superficial, Hello World programs, that sort of a thing. I didn't really write any single major application, but I was involved to some extent watching the user groups, watching meetings. My first real Ruby app was in 06 when I did my first startup, which was in the mobile, in the SMS text messaging space. We grew, we were successful. It was called Inactive, that's the URL. There isn't much there besides a website because it was primarily on mobile phones. And it used Rails. So this was the time when, you know, I think it was Rails 1.1 maybe. And Lighty and FCGI, I think, was the hot stuff back then, right? I don't know if how many people here have actually had to deploy a production app into Lighty and FCGI, but it wasn't fun, believe me. So yeah, we had like a couple of servers in our bedroom and things went well until it didn't. So that startup failed. And it didn't fail because Rails doesn't scale. Sadly, it failed because it was really hard to raise money in India. So, yeah, so that startup failed, but I got a bit of Rails experience, and it was interesting, but I don't want to digress. Let's go back to how things were back then. I'm going to look at this from the perspectives of three sort of parties involved in this. Enterprise customers, typically in terms of medium and large businesses. Local clients that are smaller businesses and individuals, and the development community. So enterprise customers at that time basically didn't know what Ruby was, and they didn't care. Local customers love PHP. And WordPress was pretty much what everybody did. And this is India, right? There wasn't really that much of an e-commerce thing going on. It was mostly static websites, and everybody just did PHP and WordPress. The developers, yeah, that was pretty much it, Java. Everybody loved Java. So a bit of a side note, around this time was when what I think was to have been the first commercially built Rails app in India was released. I can't say this for sure, but this app did go into production. This was built in ThoughtWorks India and went live, I think, around the middle of 2006, and was deployed in the US in a couple of bars. So yeah, it was an interesting application. It had DSLs, it had a touchscreen, and was built in Rails. So yeah, moving on to 2008, a couple of years. Rails 2 had just come out, Mongrel was hot, and enterprise customers were saying Ruby doesn't scale. Local customers still wondered what Ruby was, they had no idea. And developers, well, they said that they'd heard of Ruby, there was some uptake. Like I remember the first user group meeting we had, the Bangalore Ruby user group meeting in 08, must have had about five or six people attending. And all six people tried to hire each other, so. Yeah, anyway. And the rest of the community loved C#. Fast forward to today, 2010. Enterprise customers are saying Ruby is interesting. At this point, we'd already done like a couple of years or 3 years of work for large businesses, medium to large businesses, building Rails apps that were critical, not just CRUD websites or something simple. These were actually mission critical applications. Local customers were even more interesting. I happened to meet this friend of my dad's who's a chartered accountant. And he asked me what I was doing, and I said, I started a services company. And he said, in what? And I didn't really expect him to understand, but I was like, yeah, what the hell? So I said, it's in Ruby, Ruby and Rails. He's like, oh, Ruby, Rails. I'm like, dude, my cousin in Wipro doesn't know this shit. How do you know this? Right? And it turns out that his entire business runs on an open source stack, and all his ticketing for all of his customers is done through Redmine. And I thought that was pretty awesome. The dev community has changed a lot. It isn't large, but it's very enthusiastic. We've seen mature, complex open source projects come out, not many of them, but enough to take note. WebRoar is a very interesting project that doesn't get as much visibility as I think it should. It is a production-grade Rails app server, right? So you actually have a choice besides Fusion Passenger and Thin and stuff. So this is actually in use. It's supposed to be faster, but it doesn't have much visibility, but it's there. There are mature projects coming out. There is a certain degree of acceptance that GitHub is your resume. It isn't widespread yet, but we are starting to see resumes come in from candidates that say, yeah, here's my GitHub profile. Like, I think we've seen, maybe three resumes in the last few months that had. And also, for us, that means three resumes is like maybe 10 to 20% of the number of resumes we get anyway. We did RubyConf India, the first RubyConf in 2010. We had 450 people show up. Like, we originally planned for 300, and we were completely sold out, and demand was so high that we bumped it up to 450, and those sold as well. So there's a lot of traction. There are a lot of passionate people involved now. The dev community is growing, and they're interested, and they care, and they actually take steps to express their interest by traveling to, a lot of them travel to Bangalore. Like, Bangalore is just one of the hub cities for Ruby. Pune is another. Delhi, Chennai, these places have a lot of Ruby devs. And people from there travel down to Bangalore for RubyConf. So I think in terms of an expression of interest and commitment, it showed a lot. But what are the downsides? Maturity, I think, is a concern. Again, this is a subjective opinion, so take it with a pinch of salt. But what we're seeing is that while people are passionate and care, they don't have that much in terms of role models or examples to learn from. Pretty much the only thing they can do is look at open source work that exists already and try to learn how to, for example, test drive their code. That isn't the easiest thing to do, looking at open source code on GitHub, say. So maturity in terms of engineering practices still needs to come through. I think the community aspect of things is a bit of a weakness as well. because there just isn't a culture of, you know, hopping onto IRC when you need to ask questions, or hey, I need to learn this new programming language, let me join the mailing list. This whole thing of going out onto the internet and engaging with the community that exists and talking to people and learning stuff, that isn't there yet. It exists again, but it's growing. But as a consequence, learning is slow in the community. Like, concepts and ideas take time to propagate across the board, right? So in a nutshell, that's our history, right? Ruby has gone from being a complete non-entity, almost a joke, to being something that's respected and accepted and known. It isn't a large community by any means, because there are like thousands and thousands of programmers coming out of the colleges every year in India. But there is a community, it exists, it's growing, and they're very passionate. So yeah, that's it for the history. I'm going to pass the buck to Niranjan for.
Yeah. So now we'll talk a bit about what it is to be like a services company in Ruby market in India. So you have to understand one basic fact, that you are always sold out. Demand is far greater than what supply is available. So why is it so? There are really few experienced developers in Ruby. It is like really small pool, and even smaller number of companies which actually do Ruby work. Typically, a particular Ruby project tend to be small, like 2 dev pairs, 3 dev pairs, and larger projects are there, but they're pretty rare. So you don't get much larger projects, which means that whenever a particular project winds up, you have 4 to 6 people available, and because of huge supply, they get picked up immediately. Another problem we have is hiring. It's very, 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 very hard. Okay, India is generating around 50,000 engineers per year, and irrespective of their specialization, most of them actually wind up in IT industry. So hiring, actually, like going through resumes and trying to hire people, is difficult. You might get one hire out of, say, 500 resumes if you're lucky, but that's difficult. So the only solution we suspect to this particular problem is actually creating a brand to attract good people. Essentially, it's like creating a gravity well wherein people will just concentrate and they'll just come to you and work with you. Now, this is a theory. We haven't seen any major services company in India actually doing that, but we are trying to give it a shot. Now, to make the problem worse, you expect that Indian salaries will be matching the PPP ratio, which is like 1/5 of US. Like, all of you know what is PPP? It's purchasing power parity. It's like how expensive you think things are when, as compared to US and India. Say, for example, if you're buying a mobile application, which is $1 here, and $1 is like, okay, fine, I'll just go ahead and buy it. But now you convert it into INR, has 45 rupees, which is not a small amount. Okay, but actual PPP for US and India is 5. So if it is like 5 rupees in India, people will just go ahead and buy it. So it's like, it's not exact conversion from INR to USD, it's more of how things are, like if I want to go and buy a meal, how expensive it is. So yeah, considering 1/5 of PPP, we don't see salaries of Indian developers 1/5 of that equivalent to US developers. To make matters worse, average annual increments for developers is between the range of 10 to 30%, which is huge. And there's dearth of experienced developers. You don't find developers with more than 10 years experience. There is a huge social pressure because of which, even though people love programming, they have to move into management or something like that to keep people around them happy. Okay, so that's the reason a lot of good programmers who really are passionate about programming are forced to move towards different roles, which means that we don't have umpteen number of experienced programmers. And given the fact that around thousands of new developers are joining the community every year, whatever experienced programmers we have, they become even more valuable. Now, one problem with Indian community or software industries particularly right now is your number of years of experience is rewarded as against your skill set. Okay, so if you have 5 years experience or 8 years experience, your salary will grow geometrically instead of a linear curve. And it's nowhere related to like how good you are at doing things. Like a really awesome grad will still make lower than an average 2 or 3 years old experienced developer. So this is what I heard from a couple of friends and what I've gathered. Like, your salary is 2 times your number of experience in 100K. So if you're like 4 years experience, you're expecting around 800K INR salary. So, which is definitely not 1/5 of what is relative US salaries, more of 1/3. And this is what actually drives the billing rates as well. Like, as a normal Indian software service company, you would expect that the rates will be 1/5 of what you pay in US, which is not true. You would end up paying around 1/3. So that's what it is to sell services in India. Work is not a problem. You're always oversold. You have lots of work coming in, but attracting talent pool, getting new people on board, and making sure that you're maintaining your quality is a difficult proposition. Over to Sidhu.
Okay, so I'm going to now talk about the other side of the equation, which is as a prospective client, you know, what you can expect. A lot of what you'll observe as a prospective client is sort of a reflection of the things that Ranjan just pointed out as being sort of the underlying patterns in the industry itself. So the sold-out thing is going to affect you as a client, right? Most of the people you're going to speak to are pretty much sold out. If you go and Google for, you know, like 10 Ruby vendors in India to send work to, and you go speak to them, you'll find that a significant proportion of them are sold out. So talk to many providers. Don't go and narrow your list down prematurely to maybe one or two, because there's a very high probability that they just won't have people available. Find maybe 5, 6, you know, something like that. Go speak to all of them at the same time. So in a sense, luck and timing matters, because you basically have to catch somebody at the time when they've wound up a project, and nobody, again, has a great deal of visibility, because most project cycles are, you know, somewhere between a month, 4 weeks, and 6 months at the most. So with short project durations, it means that there's a lot of uncertainty around when projects end, and projects end for a lot of strange reasons fairly abruptly. So people, like companies don't have a lot of visibility. They can't basically tell you that, you know, we can promise you people in 3 months' time. There's a lot of uncertainty. So luck and timing matters. So the flip side of this is, consequently, some companies do tend to make unreasonable promises, and you can see where they're coming from, because if you as a client are coming to them and they have a lot of uncertainty around their business, they do want to try to sort of lock you in for as long as possible and see if they can, you know, sort of get work. But you have to also keep in mind that, you know, you need to hedge your bets. So keep this in mind, that some people will make unreasonable promises. So the other thing that you must keep in mind is capabilities vary. So you need to research your vendors, understand exactly which skill set, where the skill set level lies, what the level of delivery would be, and based on that, approach them. So you need to understand not just the vendor, but also your work. Consequently, you need to understand exactly what it is that you're looking for in terms of the quality of the work. If you're building something throwaway, like this is something that we have come across occasionally, which is that clients want throwaway software that, you know, does something simple that they can demo to maybe an angel investor or something. And if the investors bite, they'll come back for something, you know, more robust. In such cases, you probably don't need the most expensive or the highest quality vendor in the market. And to state the obvious, price doesn't necessarily translate to capability or quality. So I guess that's obvious, but just keep that in mind. Do your homework. This is really, really important. Dig. You really need to dig. You need to go look at the open source work that people do. You need to look at, you know, you need to get references from those people. Follow up with those references. Talk to those people. Don't just, you know, look at the names and say, oh, this is the CEO of such and such a company that's given them a reference. It must be good. Go talk to those people. If necessary, if you still feel uncomfortable, don't hesitate to interview. It's not unheard of to interview people who you're planning to hire for your project. It's just good business sense. So don't think that you're being rude. You do need to make sure that you're getting what you think you're getting. So don't hesitate to say, I want to talk to your dev. If you're not technical yourself, again, don't hesitate to go find somebody that can do this for you. A broad spectrum of rates, again, this is a very broad spectrum of rates, is between $10 an hour to $70 an hour. This is pretty much the range that you can expect in India. We ourselves used to bill at 58 on our last project before we quit to start this company. And now we bill at around 30. And this is mostly because we're new and we're seeing growth in terms of about $5 of billing per quarter. So we expect to be somewhere around 40 or 45 by the middle of next year. The other thing is, there is very little differentiation in terms of what companies claim they can do based on their websites, just external observation. everybody claims this. You know, you go to the websites, they'll say, yeah, you know, we do Cucumber, we do BDD, we do Agile, we do open source, here's our GitHub link. So you need to, like, this is just to emphasize the fact that you need to do your homework, you need to dig, you need to go in and find out exactly how skilled these people are. Because external observation, everybody looks more or less the same, okay? So let's say that you've done all of this, you've picked a vendor, okay? How do you make sure that things work? Because distributed projects do have their own risks. So rule one is you never, never, ever toss requirements over a wall, okay? Do not ever just give somebody a spec and expect to come back in a month's time and have it built for you. It may happen, there is a chance it may, but frankly, I've never seen it happen, so. Over-communicate. I can't emphasize this enough. You must over-communicate. And everything you do, anything you talk about, clarify details, never make assumptions, talk frequently, try to establish feedback loops. Okay, frequent feedback is essential, and especially essential given that you're looking at, especially US to India, you're looking at a 12-hour time differential. So if people don't have enough context and go off on down the wrong path, you're looking at like maybe 8 to 12 hours of wasted work. That adds up over time. One very good thing that we found and that we practically mandate these days is a daily stand-up. So you might want to basically say, look guys, I'm going to make sure that I have 30 minutes of my day free to do a stand-up with you. And you work out a time that's suitable for both you and your vendor. And make sure the entire team is there. It shouldn't just be, you know, there's this thing in India which you hear a lot, right? It's called the single point of contact. It's almost a title, right, on projects. Avoid this single point of contact business. Make sure that you're engaging with the entire team, the entire project, all the time. Skype is awesome, okay? This company has removed the single biggest barrier to communication across time zones. Use it extensively, everybody uses it. Just make sure you're using it to squash all resistance to talking, right? There's a natural resistance to communication. Squash it, use Skype, talk, and Skype video is even awesomer. This is something that we realized over time, which is that video calls make a big difference. I have some of my former clients out there whom we actually tried this with while we were at ThoughtWorks. And we were doing normal voice calls, VoIP calls for stand-up, and then we switched to actually doing a video conference with, you know, like the whole shebang. And the difference was amazing. Like the amount of trust that increased between our client and us, it was visible. Intense situations where things were going wrong, there was a lot less scope for, you know, finger pointing and tension. Like people were more focused on just solving the problem rather than, you know, just sort of taking off on tangents and pointing fingers. I cannot, you know, in a objective way say why it worked or why it worked better, but just seeing people's faces and knowing what they look like and seeing the expressions on their faces when they talk, it made a huge difference. And no, it isn't unreasonable to expect this, right? It may be new for the people you talk to, like the vendors, it may be new, but insist on it and you'll get into the groove and everybody is happy after that. Try to shoot for weekly iterations. One of the primary reasons is, again, besides the feedback thing, is it ensures that you're setting a fixed timeline with fixed drop points, and those timelines are short. So if things are going off track, you become aware of it, you know, far quicker. And this becomes important in the context of the 12-hour gap. So if things are going off track and you're not communicating, at least you will see, you know, where you are with a weekly showcase of what's being built. This one's a bit iffy, right? It's important, but it's very context sensitive. So you have to be careful when you're tracking this, because if you're saying that you force like 99% code coverage on a project, it isn't unheard of to find that your vendor is just writing pointless tests just to get the stupid code coverage up. So it is important, you do need to track it, but be careful as to how you bring it up with your vendor, because you don't want them to optimize for it solely at the, you know, to a ridiculous extent and not actually deliver value. Try to get a prod or a prod-like staging environment up on day one. Sorry. I think that was when my alarm ringing on Indian time. So yeah, I keep odd hours. Anyway, so try to get a prod or a prod-like staging environment up on day one and make sure that whatever software is built can be deployed on day one, even if it's just a skeleton Rails app, for example, because this sets the entire sort of pipeline in place, right from the development to the deployment to the production. You know it's all there and working, and insist that your weekly showcases for at the end of an iteration happen on this environment, not off a dev laptop. This goes a long way to ensuring engineering rigor on the project. Use a real project management tool as opposed to something like an issue tracker. Like, favor something like Pivotal Tracker or Mingle over a Jira or a Track, simply because the kind of things that an issue tracker are geared towards, they simply don't help too much when it comes to this kind of a situation. But something like Pivotal or Mingle gives you a lot more visibility and a lot more context and depth to your stories and the way you deal with it, and it helps the devs too hugely. And finally, have realistic expectations of your vendors, right? You did your homework, you researched them, you understood what they were there for, and you hired them to solve a particular problem. Now, base your expectations in a realistic manner. If you hired the absolute cream, then you can have the highest expectations. But you know, if you're paying $10 an hour and you expect TDD and all the rest of it, it's not going to happen. So it may, it's possible, but it's unlikely. So yeah, that's basically the buy side of things. To sum things up, this is largely a reflection of the sell side. Your vendors are likely to be sold out, and you should do your homework. That's the summary. So I'm going to pass the buck to Niranjan for the next bit.
Yeah. So now we'll talk a little bit about where we see Indian Ruby community growing next 5 years. Okay. So the thing is, in India right now, nothing much happens online. Everything is paperwork, or you have to call and talk to people and get stuff done. All the sites which are there, which are doing online businesses, are buggy, ugly. Even applications like, say, air ticket booking system or online trading application, you would expect them to be really robust and fast. They are there, but they still need to grow. So the reason for this is people today offer cheap software. They're very price sensitive. But things are changing now. There are a lot of companies and services which are coming in which are actually disturbing the pattern. Now, in recent past, there's been explosion of number of small and medium businesses in India, like startups, not in just technical, but in various consumer products as well. And they understand that a good and stable software is going to increase their chance of success. So the demand for quality software is rising locally. We expect that in coming five years, the local demand for product for good quality software is going to exceed the foreign demand. And Ruby is ideal place for catering to this particular market. While developers love Ruby a lot and they're really passionate about the language, what makes it really interesting for business people and startups is it's 100% open stack. It's cheap, it's available there. And it has a rich ecosystem, so that to do stuff, there are umpteen number of libraries, and using those libraries, you can build things instantaneously. You don't have to spend time in like figuring out, oh, how am I going to integrate with PayPal over REST APIs? It's there. And Ruby is really good for building web apps rapidly and in iterations. So, because of all these emerging companies and startups, overall community is moving towards high quality software. And what makes it really interesting is today's current Ruby community, their focus towards quality and TDD and design aspects of the software really helps bring that into picture. So we see in next 5 years, the community growing from development perspective, technical capabilities, as well as the business in India itself growing leaps and bounds, which gives us umpteen opportunity to actually go into the market and build something out there. So that's where we see we heading.
Yeah, sure. If there are any questions, we'd be happy to answer them. I see one hand back there.
How do you respond to a customer that has IP concerns?
So that's a subjective thing. It varies from company to company. We generally have a fairly straightforward policy, which is that our customers own all IP, with the exception of open source software written for that project, which is if we needed to enhance any open source software, clearly that doesn't belong to us. And if you had to create new open source software for that, I guess that's something that we deal with on a case-to-case basis with our customers, because sometimes it is to our customers' benefit to actually release some portion of what we build as open source. But otherwise, usually the IP is entirely owned with our owned by our customers. Your legal recourse, well, truth be told, that's a very difficult question to answer, right? Because like trying to take the legal route in India is really hard. You could take the legal route in the US, but effectively all you'd probably do with companies at the scale they are today is just kill the company, nothing more. It's not like you'd get anything out of it. So yeah, there's no good answer. Like, I'd love to be able to give you a good answer to that, but that's all there is. That said, in the last few years, I've not noticed any such issue. Like, I am fairly well involved in the community, and I haven't heard of a case where IP has been an issue. I should mention that the other approach that we are taking as well, which is if we see a great deal of potential in the client, we do go down the equity route, which is something we're exploring. I'm not sure, like, we're currently working out the legalities of that, of investing in say a US business. But yeah, that's probably an alternative where your vendor would have a vested interest in seeing you succeed. But I'm afraid I don't have any good answers. I'm sorry. I saw another hand go up there at the back.
Yeah, I was curious as to what's been happening with trying to get local developers contributing and being members of active projects.
Of?
So, of projects, trying to get folks from Railstorm.
Sure. Sure. The trend that we've seen is, I actually know of at least, of course, this Prateek Naik, right? I mean, starting there, like, Prateek was, I remember Prateek was on the Bangalore Ruby list like 4 years ago, maybe. So there's definitely one person that I can point to that went all the way to the core. But leaving him aside, let's just assume that he's on the sort of the edge of the bell curve. I do know several people, us included, that have at least one patch submitted to Rails Core. And among my Twitter social circle, I know of at least two people who are currently on the Rails project as, I forget what the exact term for them is. Not contributors. They basically review tickets and say, you know, just verify the tickets and make sure that they're actually valid, or, and if they're not valid, close them. So there are at least a couple of people who are somewhat involved in Rails. And there is a small, so I mentioned WebRoar. WebRoar is a very interesting project. There are a few others. There's a networking library called Packet. So it exists, but I will say that I wouldn't say that it is as prevalent as it could be. Like, maybe 5, 8, 10% of the existing Ruby community in India actually contributes actively to open source or semi-actively. But again, that's growing. So I clearly see a trend upward. It's increasing. I know that was rambling a bit, but did I answer your question, I hope? Yeah. I saw one more hand somewhere in the middle. Just 1 second, yeah.
Is there a certain type of project that you would say that the maybe indie development community really excels at? And on the flip side, is there any type of work or domain that you maybe wouldn't use the indie development community for?
Not really. Like, I've seen the whole spread, right? At least, like, my ThoughtWorks experience is probably a good example. I've seen the entire spread from all the way from, like, plain, simple, rock-bottom CRUD apps to, like I mentioned, like, one of the first apps was actually, like, a touch panel that played music and, you know, it was different. It had DSLs and stuff. To core banking applications built in Ruby, which didn't have a Rails component, really. Which is a rarity, frankly, in the services industry. So I've seen the entire spectrum done in India, and so I guess not. I guess everything pretty much works. One thing that is a problem usually is that I can say is designers. If you need a great UI, and this is a problem we have, this is something we tell our customers today, which is that, guys, we'll do the engineering part of it, but for great design, you're going to have to find your own people, because we haven't found anybody in India yet. It's not that they don't exist; they do exist, but Again, it's a similar situation to hiring devs. They're just few and far between. And the really good ones are independent contractors. They have no reason to really join a company. Yeah. So I saw a couple of hands.
So to add to what Sidhu just said, that while community is very much there to build any kind of application, but one thing you have to be sure of is if you are building domain rich application, you have to really, really break that communication barrier wherein you can talk to your vendor very frequently and make sure that they understand the requirements, you understand what they have understood. There are weekly deployments, there are weekly showcases, and it's going into agile manner so that you know exactly where the product is going. Otherwise, it can go down the drain. But it's true for any product. It's not just Ruby industry as such.
So yeah, I saw a couple of hands here.
Yep.
To the seat.
I think the other gentleman asked part of my question. India's software industry strength has been more on the service side than on the product side. So I don't know if Ruby and Rails is helping switch that.
I don't know about if it's helping the numbers, but we're definitely seeing a lot more companies. I swear I've seen more Rails product startups than anything else, easily. Like if you go to Pune especially, Pune is like a total hotspot for product startups that run off Rails. I'm not sure if the numbers are really being changed in terms of the number of devs being involved, but the number of businesses, we're definitely seeing like a huge number of startups that are like mostly on Rails in India. Like almost all startups in India are on Rails. I tend to exaggerate. Maybe not almost all, but like a non-trivial number. Like everybody I speak to, like most of them do seem to be on Rails. So, yeah.
At the end of your presentation, you talked about the way you see India growing into the future, and it sounded like some really positive outcomes there. I hope that happens. I'm excited to see that. What could someone like myself or the other people in the room or the rest of the world do to help ensure that India meets that success?
So that's an interesting and a very good question. So one of the things that we've wrestled with for a long time while we were consulting at ThoughtWorks, now in this business, is I was actually wondering whether I should put this into the presentation. I did, and then it became kind of too long. But I'll talk about it in brief anyway, which is that, quite frankly, India today is, while it's a bit of a chance, it's like getting into a stock market that's about to boom. It's as simple as that, right? There is a chance that it may not, but all indicators seem to say that it will. And if you're in there and you establish yourself as a dev, it cuts both ways. One is that India currently has a dearth of experienced engineers, simply in terms of the number of people we have to pair inexperienced people with to learn from. And I don't mean inexperienced in terms of years, right? Even people have a lot of years, but who don't have experience with a particular platform. The ability to find other experienced people who do have that knowledge and then pair them off with these people, that's really low today. So having experienced engineers from outside come in and work with Indian engineers is going to make a huge difference, because the people there are really passionate. They really care about doing stuff well. It's just that they don't have anybody to learn from. So that would make a big difference. And the flip side of it is, because I am a bit of an objectivist, yeah? So the truth of the matter is, while it's a bit chancy and for somebody, quite bluntly, from the first world to come to India, it will change your lifestyle a bit, maybe even significantly. But the upside of it, the potential upside of it, is that should the market actually boom the way it will, this is going to go through the roof. Like, the amount of software that's going to be needed to support the Indian market is just insane. Like, it's like everything that the US did since like 1980 to now is going to happen over like the next 10 years. There's going to be like an explosion. And the good news is that a lot of what applied to first world economies that worked there, we can already see working here. So we're seeing the equivalent of Kayak. .com in the US is one of the most successful startups in India today, easily. And they're a Lisp Ruby shop, right? Amazon, book sales, Flipkart.com in India. These guys have just gone through the roof in 12 months flat, 12 to 14 months, and they're generating so much money, it's insane. And this is just scratching the surface. So if you do move there, for example, like that's my primary thing, like which involves considerable discomfort, which means, you know, you basically give up the first world, move to the third world, hoping that, you know, things are going to take off. But if you do, the upsides are insane, potentially.
Thank you.
I'm not sure if I ramble again, but I'm not sure if I answered your question properly, but yeah, that's my perspective.